Dr. Maria Ritzema, and I'm an assistant professor at College of DuPage. And I am going to give this lecture as a world historian. So we're going to look at China's place kind of in the world. So I'm going to hit a lot of the highlights of China, like some of the dynasties that were trading outside and what made them so wealthy and powerful. And then I'm going to go quickly through all of these and just hit the highlights. And then most of the focus on the modern is going to focus on Latin America. And it represents what they've been doing in Africa and Sri Lanka as well. And I'll hit those at the end if we can. So let's share the screen. Let's see if it's working. Hopefully you can all see the entry screen and that I can then turn. All right. So, as historian Valerie Hansen has stated, quote, "The Chinese have been writing history books for a long time," end quote. So because of this, scholars know more about China than just about anywhere else, pretty much any society on earth. For our purposes, China today means the People's Republic of China, even though the original part of China, as you can see from these maps, and where people were writing with the Chinese characters all the way back in like 1200 BCE, even though those areas only encompassed a tiny area compared to now. From this tiny area of the Shao Dynasty and of the Shang Dynasty, it starts around the Yellow River Valley, then it grows to the Yangtze River Valley. And finally, around 1000 of the current era, it spreads south into the Pearl River Valley. So as China grew, it absorbed different peoples, cultures, and languages into the whole. One of the earliest hints of China's role as a world power in their past comes from the Han Dynasty, which was, well, roughly 200 BCE to 220 of the current era. The Qin Dynasty prior had kind of set up the bureaucracy that would be needed to run a strong dynasty. But when the Han came in, they kind of improved on it, they adapted, and were able to create a bureaucracy. And this was a new thing, this kind of form of government. And it allowed the Han Dynasty to rule for about 400 years. During this dynasty, we get one of the world's first historians, a man by the name of Sima Qian. He wrote The Records of the Grand Historian. And he wrote this around the first century before the current era. Now, he was writing for his Han ruler, so we have to take some of what he says as maybe an exaggeration to flatter those he is writing for. You know, he wants to keep his job. But much of what he wrote was actually corroborated by other evidence, archaeological evidence. Sima wrote of the accounts of Zhang Qian, a Han Dynasty envoy to the world outside China in the second century BCE. He was the first official diplomat to bring back reliable information about Central Asia to the Chinese imperial court, and he played an important pioneering role in Chinese colonization and conquest of the region now known as Xinjiang. Today, Zhang Qian's travels are associated with the major trade routes of transcontinental trade, the Silk Road. Through the Silk Road, China traded with Central Asia, the Middle East, and the Roman Empire. Zhang's missions opened up to China, the many kingdoms and products of a part of the world then unknown to the Chinese. And then he opened up parts of the world to the luxury goods of China that were unknown to them. Now, following Zhang Qian's missions and reports, commercial relations between China and Central as well as Western Asia flourished. Many Chinese missions were sent throughout the end of the second century BCE into the first century BCE, and this initiated the development of the Silk Road. Many objects were soon exchanged. The Roman historian Florus described the visit of numerous envoys, including Chinese, to the first Roman emperor Augustus, who reigned between 27 and 14 before the current era. Several Roman embassies to China then followed, as Chinese chronicles state. So already in Roman times, emperors were wearing silks from China, and sending lots of cash back to China to pay for those silks. But as you can see, this was great distance. You know, this had to be carried by caravan. So the trade volume was kind of low due to the distance. But closer to home, Chinese influence is already spreading into East and Central Asia. Now, after the Han period, China started growing and expanding. And the next great dynasty was probably the Tang Dynasty. The Tang Dynasty is often referred to as China's golden age. For most of the first and second millennium, China was perhaps the world's most important trading nation. By sea, this trading system stretched all the way from East Africa to India, to Thailand, to Java, to Korea, and to Japan. By land, it reached through Central Asia, all the way to Persia, and into Europe, across those various routes that together formed that famous Silk Road. Now, already during the Tang Dynasty, China had a large urban population. And like a lot of urban people, these city dwellers, you know, they had a taste for imported goods of all kinds. During the Tang Dynasty, the Chinese capital city of Chang'an, which is now Xi'an, was probably the world's largest city. It covered over 30 square miles, and it included a population estimated at around 2 million people. Chang'an marked the eastern terminus of the Silk Road, and therefore, in addition to Chinese people, the city was home to tens of thousands of foreigners. Now, most of the foreigners in Chang'an were either merchants, monks, or diplomats. But in the city, you would have found people of all the world, major world religions at the time, plus many that are now rare or extinct. You would find Muslims, Jews, and Christians, as well as Persian Zoroastrians, Manichaeans, Central Asian Nestorian Christians, and Indian Buddhists, all of whom had come from the West on the Silk Road. There were various peoples from places like Korea, Japan, and Southeast Asia. And there were even sub-Saharan Africans from the great trading cities of the East Coast of Africa, known as the Swahili Coast. Chang'an in the 9th century was the world's most cosmopolitan city, and in it you could find just about anything the world had to offer. Now, the reason why so many merchants were in the Tang capital was that the people in Chang'an had a taste for foreign luxuries and the wealth to buy them. The Chinese state actively promoted trade, both imports and exports, by investing massively in transportation infrastructure. All of this trade and infrastructure helped produce a sophisticated cash economy that in turn helped produce a very prosperous merchant class in the major cities. During the Tang Dynasty, ships from as far away as the Persian Gulf were visiting South China ports. In Chang'an, you could buy sandalwood from India, Indian and Burmese black pepper, frankincense from Somalia, ivory from sub-Saharan Africa. You could buy Persian dates, saffron, and pistachios. You could buy foreign food and liquor. You could, sources tell of Indian merchants selling Indian breads and sweets on the streets. You could go out to Persian restaurants where you might be served by attractive young women from the West who work there as waitresses and dancers. One reason we know about this is because of poems written by the great Tang Chinese poet Li Po. He wrote many he wrote about a lot of his exploits in these foreign bars and restaurants. Even though he spent way too much money in them, he couldn't stop going to them. Chang'an was probably the only city in the world around 1000 of the current era where you could find just about everyone and everything in the known world. So you can think of Chang'an then as Chicago today, a place where people from around the world were attracted to come and do business and then to stay and live. So like Chicago, Chang'an was a center to which many other civilizations were drawn. Now, after the decline of the Tang Dynasty, the next major dynasty was the Song Dynasty. So even though the Song Dynasty didn't control all of United China for a while, they had to split and you ended with a Northern and a Southern Song. The Southern Song Dynasty that lasted from about 1127 to 1279, while it may have controlled a smaller territory, it still participated in trade just as much as in the Tang time. To protect and support the multitudes of ships sailing for maritime interests into the waters of the East China Sea and the Yellow Sea to Korea and Japan, to Southeast Asia, the Indian Ocean, and the Red Sea, it was necessary to establish an official standing navy. So China established their first permanent navy in 1132. The Song period was a time of sophistication. The populace engaged in vibrant social and domestic life and enjoyed many public festivals, such as the Qingming Festival. This is just a scene from the Qingming Scroll, which is several feet long. And it goes from, starts in a rural area and goes on the roads through the cities. So you see all the different peoples and goods and the way Chinese people were living at this time. People were enjoying social clubs and entertainments in the cities. Some of the largest cities of the world were in China during the Song period, and a few of them boasted over 1 million people. And we know that foreigners were still living in China, because many of the chronicles talk about people joining the exotic food club, where they would eat the food of the many different ethnic foreigners who were coming to live and trade in China. Now, after the Song Dynasty, the next major dynasty that reflected China's world power was the Yuan Dynasty. This is the dynasty founded by Kublai Khan, grandson of Genghis Khan. And while the Mongols did use terror tactics to conquer China and elsewhere, once in power in China, they did all they could to promote trade along the Silk Road. For example, the Mongol government gave out metal discs to act as passes for envoys and messengers that traveled along the Silk Road and across the empire. This way, when you had one of these discs, it acted as a pass. The bearer of the disc did not have to carry money. It entitled the bearer to food, a place to stay, feed for their horses, and a fresh mount. Marco Polo's travels record that he and his uncles received a total of 7 of these passes, meaning they must have made several trips across the empire. Kublai Khan strongly supported the Silk Road trade network, allowing the transmission of Eastern and Western technologies. So these routes were not just a conduit for silk, even though we call them the Silk Road. Many products, many peoples, and many ideas went along these routes. They were important paths for cultural and technological transmission that linked traders, merchants, pilgrims, missionaries, soldiers, nomads, and urban dwellers from China, India, Persia, and the Mediterranean countries for thousands of years. Now, from the Yuan Mongol dynasty, which only lasted about 100 years, the next major dynasty was the Ming dynasty. Ming China was a major commercial and military power. They were a major naval power in trade and warfare, as the Chinese were the first to mount cannons on ships. To illustrate China's place as a world power during the Ming dynasty, I'm going to talk about the voyages of Admiral Zheng He. Zheng He had been forgotten about in Chinese history for a while, but in the last 15 or 20 years, he has reemerged as a popular hero and as a symbol of China's economic and military might on the world stage. In 1405, 87 years before Columbus's voyage to the New World, a huge fleet of ships left South China on a voyage through the South China Sea, through the Indian Ocean, to the Persian Gulf, and eventually the coast of East Africa. The largest of these ships were over 200 feet long and carried thousands of men. These huge ships were accompanied by hundreds of other boats that carried water, provisions, horses, scientists, and soldiers. All in all, this Ming Armada carried over 20,000 men and was the largest fleet ever assembled. It wouldn't be until World War I or II that you got a larger one. These huge ships were called Baoshuan in Chinese, or treasure ships, because they were loaded with valuable Chinese trade goods, porcelains, silks, metalware, and lacquerware. In return, the Chinese were looking to bring home exotic luxury goods, such as ivory, rhino horn, tortoiseshell, spices, medicines, gems, and so on. Now, during a 30-year period, the Chinese emperor sent out 7 of these huge naval trading expeditions. And during this time, China essentially controlled most of the waterways of the known world. From the Pacific to the southern Indian Ocean, Chinese naval and commercial power was unparalleled in the world at a time 50 years or so before Columbus and Vasco da Gama voyaged out. So it seemed like China was poised to become a major colonial power. The Chinese held sway in ports from Japan to Africa. By the time da Gama finally made it around the southern end of Africa and sailed up the East African coast in 1498, the African traders he encountered were wearing fine Chinese silk caps and scoffed at the crappy trade goods the Portuguese had to offer. The Africans were also unimpressed by da Gama's ships, which were puny compared to the huge Chinese treasure ships. But just when the Chinese were poised to take over the known world, internal problems led the Chinese to focus on China itself, and they abandoned their nascent maritime empire. In 1477, xenophobic Confucian officials in Beijing claimed that the treasure ship voyages had been a waste of state resources that brought nothing in return to China. They argued that a desire for contact with the outside world implied that China needed something from abroad and was not strong and self-sufficient in and of itself. So these Confucian officials argued that the world should come to China. China should not go out to the world. And that is basically what happened. The world still went to China for their fine luxury goods for hundreds of years. Now, Europeans start showing up in China around the 1500s. And everybody wanted a piece of the China trade because China had so much that Europeans and later Americans wanted. They had those silks, those porcelain, and that tea. Now, by the 1500s, while other cultures now had mastered silk production, they could not match the quality of weaving that the Chinese had achieved. They had pioneered silk production, and no one could match it. The same with porcelain. So what do we call those fine dishes that we lay out when our, you know, when it's Christmas or Thanksgiving? China. The country is synonymous with fine ceramics because for centuries, no one could compete. Now, Europeans paid for all these luxury goods with silver that they were getting from the New World. This large influx of silver into the Chinese economy had a positive effect on many Chinese cities, especially along the southern coast and the large inland rivers. In these coastal urban areas, the increase in trade and the influx of silver promoted new businesses and new production for export. There were big investments in the silk production industry and a rise in exports. Now, when the Qing Dynasty came in after conquering the Ming, they also wanted to keep China on top as an economic and military power. They conquered huge territories to the north, west, and south of China, so that after the first 100 years of the dynasty, the Qing controlled a much larger territory than any previous Chinese dynasty. By the 18th century, there were significant increases in cultural ties between the East and the West, with new products, technologies, and ideas going back and forth along those the Silk Road routes and the maritime routes. However, during the 18th century, the Qing government set up a rigid system of control over all merchants who wanted to trade with China. All foreign merchants were restricted to small enclaves in certain southern port cities, and foreign merchants could only deal with government agents, not Chinese merchants themselves. And furthermore, all Chinese goods had to be paid for in cash, meaning silver. They weren't going to accept any trade goods for them. You want the porcelain, you got to pay silver. So as more Chinese goods went west, more European silver went east, and at the time there was nothing Europeans could do about it. When the King of England sent George Macartney to China in 1792 to negotiate, like, can we keep an ambassador in Beijing? Can we change this trade relationship where we can, you know, maybe deal directly with merchants, where we can offer goods in kind? You know, don't you want some fine British woolens? You know, the British are tired of losing all of their silver. The Qing Emperor Qianlong had this to say in response to King George III. The various articles presented by you, O King, this time are accepted by my special order, in consideration of the offerings having come from a long distance with sincere good wishes. As a matter of fact, the virtue and prestige of the Celestial Dynasty, having spread far and wide, has caused the kings of the myriad nations to come by land and sea with all sorts of precious things. Consequently, there is nothing we lack, as your principal envoy has observed. We have never set much store on strange and ingenious objects, nor do we need any more of your country's manufacturers. The importance of this quote demonstrates that at the end of the 18th century, the Chinese were a major world power. Qianlong was able to snub the King of England and the entire British merchant establishment and get away with it. The Chinese at the end of the 18th century were in the position of power. They knew it, and so did the Europeans. However, this would change in a short 50 years. As the Qing government had to deal with more and more internal problems, the British and later other Europeans and Americans were industrializing to overcome their shortcomings in terms of manufacturing compared to China. With industrialization came new technologies, not only in terms of product manufacturing, but weapons and militarization. When the British tried to trade opium for tea in the mid-19th century instead of using silver, Chinese officials destroyed some of that opium. The British were then able to use their new military industrial weapons and ships to blast their way into China and force better terms of trade for the British, Americans, and other Europeans. This was the beginning of the century of humiliation for the Chinese. China fell further behind the West and had to deal with not only internal problems, but then world wars as well. Once Mao emerged as the leader and established the People's Republic of China after World War II, a major policy for Chinese leaders was to reclaim their status as a world power, if not to be the world power. Starting in the 1980s and 90s under Deng Xiaoping, there was a push in China for economic and openness reforms. Although there is a debate on whether or not Deng actually said it, his perceived catchphrase, quote, "to get rich is glorious," end quote. This idea unleashed a wave of personal entrepreneurship that continues to drive China's economy today. Deng was instrumental in the opening of Shanghai's Pudong New Area and revitalizing the city as China's economic hub. In 1993, President Jiang Zemin coined the new term socialist market economy to move China's centrally planned socialist economy into essentially a government-regulated capitalist market economy. This was a huge step to take in the advancement of Deng's socialism with Chinese characteristics. Deng's insistence on economic openness aided in the phenomenal growth levels of the coastal areas, especially the Golden Triangle region that surrounded Shanghai. In the 1990s, the focus of the reform was on the banking system as well as industrial reform. The continuance of economic reform led to economic growth in the 90s. Today, there are economic sectors in which business can thrive, and this has opened up economic freedom and access to goods. In agriculture, private ownership of production assets became legal. The government encouraged non-agricultural activities, such as village enterprises in rural areas, and promoted more self-management for state-owned enterprises, which increased competition in the marketplace and facilitated direct contact between Chinese and foreign trading enterprises. China also relied more upon foreign financing and imports. Restraints on foreign trade were relaxed and joint ventures were encouraged. Urban economic reform was aimed at integrating China more fully with the international economy. The development of the private sector was allowed and it was permitted to compete with state firms in a number of sectors. Central government planning was reduced. Deng Xiaoping's legacy is very complex and opinions are divided about it, but Deng changed China from a country obsessed with mass political movements to a country focused on economic construction. Deng Xiaoping's policies are among some of the most successful industrializations in human history. In a little over 30 years, his policies were able to move China from the peasant society it once was to an industrial superpower whose industrial output is only second to that of the United States and is now a world leader in the economic market. Now, while Deng Xiaoping prioritized an external stable environment to achieve economic development, current President Xi Jinping seems to put a greater emphasis on using economic means for the pursuit of security goals. According to Audrey Wong, China has been using economic diplomacy more and more since the 2000s. This has included expanded trade and investment frameworks, as well as visiting other nations. By 2010, as we said, China had the world's second largest economy, and they see reforming economic governance and exerting a greater international influence as the reasons that they achieved that position, and as a way to take their economy to the top spot. President Xi Jinping is encouraging even more outward investment by Chinese firms. These overseas investments, often in developing initiatives in places like Africa and Latin America, are crucial to continuing China's own internal development. So that's where we're going to move to now. This Chinese investment in other places, focusing right now on Latin America. Most of the information on this Latin America part comes from Kevin Gallagher and Deborah Brautigam and Audrey Wong. So from 2003 to 2013, Latin America experienced what's called a China boom. Now the boom has kind of leveled off and Latin America still has to navigate this China triangle. The tips of the triangle are the United States, Latin America, and China. But China's alliance with Latin America is seen by some as a challenge to the US, a nation that has long considered the Americas to be its backyard, where the US has a lot of the say-so of what happens there. And so it's not always viewed as a good thing. Now, for the last 30 years, China's has grown at over 10% every year, the fastest and strongest economic growth ever recorded. In 2001, China entered the World Trade Organization and soon began purchasing and selling with the rest of the world. As China has risen, it has been guzzling oil from Venezuela, Ecuador, and Mexico to fuel its expanding fleet of cars, trucks, and container ships. China has wired more than half of the world's consumer electronics products with copper from Chile and Peru, and much of the steel in China's new cities is made with iron ore from Brazil. As standards of living have risen, the Chinese eat more beef from cattle that are fed on soybeans from Argentina and Brazil. And in turn, Chinese companies have flocked to the Americas to invest in these commodities, and they are backed by China's state-run development banks. So Latin America is seen as key for resources for China. Now, at the turn of the 21st century, Latin American trade with China was only 1% of Latin American trade, about $12 billion. But by 2013, it was $289 billion, and China was the number one trading partner for many of Latin America's biggest economies, like Brazil, Peru, and Chile. Because Chinese consumption of these goods made these goods more scarce, the price of the goods went up in the local marketplace, which allowed the region to enjoy that massive commodity boom. This boom triggered investment in the region's commodity sector by Chinese companies and other global firms. The rates of new trade and foreign investment into the region was both remarkable and welcome. Perhaps the most remarkable is that China has provided massive amounts of finance to Latin American governments for infrastructure, mining, and energy projects. China has provided upward of $119 billion in loans and lines of credit to Latin American governments since 2003. In many ways, China's appetite for Latin American commodities has been a savior for the Americas, especially in the wake of the global financial crisis when trade and finance from the West dried up. Latin America rode the coattails of the boom in China, also growing at an annual rate of 3.6% from 2003 to 2013. This return to economic growth brought a rise to an emerging middle class in many Latin American countries. For the first time in a century, Latin American governments started putting a dent in rising inequality. While the US wasn't paying attention, Latin America quickly became of the utmost strategic importance for China as a source for those key natural resources that it needs to grow its economy and to feed the appetites of more than a billion people. In January 2015, the Chinese sat down with the Latin American region as a whole and put together a cooperation plan with the region that on paper could be a perfect complement to Latin American reform. China pledged to boost trade to $500 billion and investment to $250 billion over the next decade. To demonstrate that it means business, China created a new set of funds, upwards of $35 billion, for infrastructure investment in Latin America. Now, Chinese finance does come with a few strings attached. China may tacitly require that Chinese companies have a hand in these projects, but China has avoided meddling in domestic policy, and this is an attractive feature for many Latin American governments. The new joint cooperation plan also puts a premium on cooperation in science, technology, and innovation policy. In addition to the sharing of technology, China pledges to start a dialogue about the establishment of Chinese industrial parks across Latin America. If similar agreements with Africa are any indication, China means business, having established at least 6 industrial parks in Africa by 2015. These were modeled after those special economic zones that were an engine of the Chinese growth miracle. Places like, the Shenzhen Special Economic Zone or the Pudong New Area. China's industrial parks can help diversify Latin America's economies and make them more competitive. In 2004, Brazil's then president Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva brought close to 400 Brazilian business people to China on a major trade and investment mission. Lula was keen to accelerate trade relations with the Chinese. Lula had been campaigning for decades against the so-called Washington Consensus. Citing more of the same, Lula was looking to sever negotiations on the free trade area of the Americas. Lula thought he could get a better deal by trading with the Chinese. By the time Lula left office in 2011, China was Brazil's leading trading partner, and his country was making headlines the world over for its newfound growth, emerging middle class, and endless promise. To grow at the pace China did, they needed significant supplies of natural resources like oil, iron ore, copper, soybeans, and beef. You know, those were needed to build those cities, to provide inputs to the rapidly expanding factories, and to feed its modernizing nation. So Latin America joined in on that and rode on those coattails. By 2013, most countries in the region had China as their number one or number two trading partner. 80% of those exports from Latin America to China were in oil, soybeans, iron, copper, and wool. Following those imports, Chinese energy and mining companies started investing in Latin America to get in on the action. Chinese firms have not only been supplying investment, but have also been linking Latin America to Asia's accelerating production networks. China is the largest trading nation as well as a massive importer. China became the largest importer of soybeans by 2009, and by 2014, it accounted for 70% of the global imports of soy. But the real jackpot is oil, gas, copper, and iron ore, which are some of Latin America's most abundant natural resources. The vast majority of Latin American exports to China are in a handful of those primary commodities. In 2014, China became the largest importer of oil in the world, and that sector has been a key area of foreign direct investment in Latin America, with Chinese firms flocking to get into those Latin American oil markets. Now, whereas food and beverage producers from Latin America invest in China in order to sell directly to Chinese consumers or to manage their exports to China, some of Latin America's manufacturing companies go to China just to get in on the robust value chains that have emerged there. Imports from China have been just as remarkable as exports to China for Latin America. Imports have grown by a factor of 20 since the year 2000. Latin America imports a wide variety of manufactured goods from China. So China's presence in Latin America is no longer solely through export and import markets. Increasingly, Latin Americans engage with the rapidly growing stock of Chinese companies that have set up shop across the Americas. China's oil and gas giants, mining companies, manufacturers, auto companies, all have plants across Latin America, mostly in South America. Now in 2001, Chinese Premier Zhu Rongji recommended that China embark on a going out strategy that would encourage its flagship firms to invest abroad and bid for global contracts. This was part of his country's 10th five-year plan. Many measures of the plan were to encourage overseas investments by China's big companies, and this remains in place today. A department was established to research opportunities and risks associated with investing in various countries and sectors. Guidelines and regulations were set for the behavior of overseas companies. Kevin Gallagher and his associates estimate that between 2002 and 2012, Chinese firms were extended approximately $140 billion in loans and lines of credit specifically to go abroad. Between 2002 and 2013, China's overseas foreign direct investment flows grew from $2.7 billion to $90 billion. In 2012, Chinese firms poured $9.2 billion into Latin American countries in the form of new plants or mergers and acquisitions. Over 94% of all Chinese foreign direct investment into Latin America goes into the energy, mining, and food sectors. This contrasts with other foreign investors who mostly invest in manufacturing and services. What also makes Chinese investment into Latin America distinct is that it is dominated by state-owned enterprises rather than by private sector multinationals. Private sector actors represent only about 13% of the total and concentrate largely in the manufacturing and services sectors, which are in the small end of investment. Now, as I stated, by far and away, the largest Chinese investments in Latin America are in energy and mining. And these are dominated by China's big three large state-owned firms. Firms in the sectors are more apt to merge with or acquire existing operations in order to learn about and adapt to new conditions as they globalize. China's overseas oil and gas companies are more likely to sell a newly acquired barrel of oil on the world markets than to ship it home. Argentina and Brazil are the recipients of the majority of Chinese investment in the oil and gas sectors. In March of 2010, China National Offshore Oil Corporation, or CNOOC, acquired a 50% stake in the Argentine firm of Brightest Company for a staggering $3.1 billion. CNOOC teamed with Brightest to mix its knowledge of offshore with onshore production, leaving the company to be largely managed by the founders of Brightest, the Bulgaroni family. Since Brightest has a 40% stake in Pan American Energy Corporation, or PAE, this merger granted CNOOC access to Argentina's large Cerro Dragón petroleum reserve, which was operated by PAE. Sinopec, the Chinese petroleum companies, are in what are called downstream operations, refining and sales. However, the firm has begun to rapidly expand into upstream operations, the exploration and production of oil and gas, as well as a number of other petroleum-based chemicals. Sinopec's largest acquisition in Latin America was the purchase of a 40% stake in the Spanish firm Repsol's Brazilian operations for $7.1 billion in 2010, and they then invested another $1 billion 3 years later. Now, related to these energy investments is China's investments in the electricity sector. China's mammoth state grid corporation, the largest electricity company in the world, made two major acquisitions in Brazil, totaling $2.2 billion. The first was the acquisition of 7 national electricity transmission companies and 12 transmission lines. Mining investments are also of an immense scale. In 2011, a group of 5 Chinese state-owned enterprises purchased a 15% stake in the Brazilian mining firm that I'm not going to pronounce because I do not speak Portuguese, but they bought it for $2 billion. This granted the Chinese firm access to rare earth elements in Brazil. But Chinese firms are most active in Peru, where Chinese firms are engaged in at least 8 mining projects. What about agriculture? China has also been promoting foreign investment in Latin America's agricultural sector, especially in the planting of seeds, cotton, and vegetables, the harvesting and shipping of timber, and ocean fisheries. In 2005, Pengxin Group, a private Chinese company, purchased land for soybean production in Santa Cruz, Bolivia. Zhenjiang Foodie and Chongqing Grain Group had similar purchases in Brazil. Chinese companies are also getting on Chile's world-class wineries, with the Chinese wine firm Great Wall purchasing Chilean land to produce wine. Chinese agricultural firms have been investing in pressing plants, mills, and more across the Americas. But still, relative to energy and mining and even manufacturing, agriculture investment in Latin America is small. The Chinese manufacturing presence, while also small, is growing in Latin America. And this growth is geared toward getting better access to domestic markets in Latin America. These would then serve as an export platform to other nearby markets, and these would also help to acquire technology and know-how. The Chinese firm Lenovo purchased the ThinkPad from IBM back in 2005. That move helped the company get instant brand recognition, market share, and technology. Lenovo is a private company, and it's now one of the largest electronic companies in the world. They started their Brazil operation in 2005, shortly after acquiring ThinkPad. In 2012, Lenovo acquired Brazil's CCE. It's one of its large computer firms, and doubled its market share in Brazil, which is the third largest computer market in the world. In 2009, Lenovo opened a manufacturing and distribution plant in an industrial cluster in Mexico, where it produces and sells its product to other NAFTA countries, meaning Canada, the US, and Mexico. China's car companies are also going global and can now be found in Brazil, Mexico, and Uruguay. Between 2006 and 12, China announced a total of nearly $6 billion of auto-related investments in Latin America. Uruguay is also becoming a hotspot and testing ground for China's fast-growing automotive companies. Uruguay is part of the Mercosur Agreement, a common market and free trade zone between Brazil, Argentina, Uruguay, Paraguay, and now Venezuela. With its skilled and reliable workforce, its more stable political environment, and its close proximity to Argentina and Brazil, Uruguay is fast becoming a place to manufacture goods for re-export into other Mercosur countries. Chinese textile, telecom, chemical, and auto companies are flocking to Uruguay. Chery Automobile Company produced its first car in mainland China in 1999. By 2013, it had 20 different models and the capacity to produce 900,000 cars a year. In 2007, Chery joined forces with the Socma company from Argentina to form Chery Socma. The Uruguay plant makes a number of models for the regional and domestic market. Now, rather than source from local firms, Chery Socma assembles complete knockdown kits. These kits that are fully imported from mainland China and then assembled in the Uruguay plant. They can produce 32 to 36 cars a day. Chery has been expanding and now has auto plants in Brazil and Venezuela. What about services? China's two telecom giants, Huawei and ZTC, are private companies and the government does not hold any shares. In 2009, Brazil's largest landline telecom company, Telenor, purchased network equipment from Huawei by taking advantage of Huawei's huge line of credit with the Chinese Development Bank. The CDB offered Telenor a 2-year grace period on paying up the loan, and the interest rate was fairly low. Mexico's giant, America Mobile, also went to the Chinese Development Bank in 2009 to purchase $1 billion to upgrade its mobile network. It is deals like these that helped Huawei surpass Ericsson in 2012 to become the largest telecommunications provider in the world. The next services frontier in Latin America for China looks to be banking. China has been loosening its remaining restrictions on the globalization of its financial sector. And one of China's four big banks, ICBC, took an 80% stake of Standard Bank in Argentina in 2011 for $700 million. And the other four big banks are increasing their presence in Latin America as well. Now, during the China boom, trade improved for the region, partly due to a decline in prices because of the increase in competitive imports from China. Decreases in prices usually benefit consumers since they'll have more money to save and spend if prices are low. By the mid-2000s, the Latin American economy started to become linked to the fate of the Chinese economy. Small changes in the Chinese economy have an impact on Latin American currency and capital markets. In 2013, China's new president Xi Jinping paid a visit to Latin America and provided upward of $5.3 billion in financing for energy and infrastructure projects. At the same time, Chinese businessmen started negotiations with Daniel Ortega of Nicaragua to build and finance an alternative to the Panama Canal through that country. During the summer of 2014, Xi and his people were back in the Western Hemisphere. The Chinese stayed in the region for a week, visiting Brazil, Argentina, Venezuela, and Cuba, and provided another $21 billion for new projects. Now, you might recall the saying dollar diplomacy. This was the policy of William Howard Taft to provide finance to Latin American governments to promote U.S. commercial and political interests in the region. And this has now been replaced with yuan diplomacy. By 2014, Chinese development banks were providing more finance to Latin American governments than the World Bank or the Inter-American Development Bank. China, they are the new banks in town. Not only does China have deep pockets, Chinese finance tends to flow to countries that have a hard time gaining access to global market, global capital markets. What's more, Chinese billions in finances are more in line with what Latin American nations want, rather than what Western development experts say they need. Whereas the US and international finance institutions like the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank tend to finance in line with latest development fads like trade liberalization or sometimes health and education, Chinese loans tend to go to energy, infrastructure, and industry projects in a region that has an infrastructure gap. Latin America's roads, ports, telecommunication networks, and energy systems are severely lacking, and so these loans are helping develop those. Chinese loans don't come with the harsh strings attached to the other financial institutions. The international financial institutions are notorious for their conditionalities that make borrowers sign on to austerity and structural adjustment programs that have questionable outcomes on growth and equality in the region. China is becoming bold and taking on more risk in part because of its innovative finance schemes. Half of Chinese finance is in the form of a unique lending instrument, the commodity-backed loan. This allows Latin American governments to ship hundreds of thousands of barrels of oil to China to partly repay the loan, so they don't have to come up with cash to do it. Not only has the new financing helped Latin American governments meet their needs, it has improved the profile of Latin Americans in the eyes of the global investment community. If countries pay back on their loans, they get upgraded in their bond rating, which allows other countries to secure more global capital markets. So yuan diplomacy is paying off, and it pays off in other ways as well. China is now viewed as becoming very influential across the region. Now, the US is still seen as more influential than China, on the whole, but China is now seen to be having a more positive influence than the United States. I'm actually going to skip some of this banking information and go to this good neighbor policy. Now, Chinese loans, as I said, come with the tacit understanding that Chinese companies will be doing a significant amount of the work related to the project, or that the project will involve Chinese imports. For example, Chexim, a Chinese company, gives 100% export credits, like a 2010 $1.7 billion loan to pay a Chinese company to build the Coca-Cola Sinclair hydroelectric dam in Ecuador. In a 2011 loan to Ecuador to finance Ecuador's annual budget and to invest in hydroelectricity energy projects, the hydro projects were awarded to Chinese firms. Now, Chinese finance in Latin America is causing conflicting types of consternation in the global community. In a Washington Post opinion piece, the author stated, quote, China is a master at lowball financing, fashioning loans of billions of dollars at tiny interest rates that can stretch beyond 20 years, which is a headache for Western competitors, which long ago agreed not to use financing as a competitive tool, end quote. Others interpret China's finance in Latin America and beyond in the opposite manner, arguing that Chinese finance is exploitative and even neo-colonial. Kevin Gallagher and his colleagues came to the conclusion that by and large, Chinese finance is neither sweetheart nor neo-colonial. Rather, China's policy banks behave in a fairly similar manner to other development financial institutions operating in the region, such as the World Bank, the Inter-American Development Bank, and the Development Bank of Latin America. Now, Chinese finance in Latin America is becoming very popular because it operates under a different set of enforcement standards when compared to conventional finance. When Chinese banks come, they don't impose those policy conditionalities of any kind. Chinese partners treat them as equals, and they want to do business. By contrast, the IMF and World Bank impose stringent conditions on its borrowers. The IMF is notorious for imposing strict budgetary conditions on recipient nations and requiring nations to slash social spending in order to meet those conditions. Now, although the World Bank did not tell Rio how to use a loan it gave it in 2011, it would not transfer the loan until Rio fulfilled a two-page list of conditions, such as a levy. They had to levy a fee on water users, they had to implement disaster risk mitigation policy, they had to restructure the Secretariat of Social Assistance and Human Rights, and the list just went on and on. The policies that the international financial institutions impose on their borrowers are not necessarily bad policies. But any imposition of policies by foreign creditors has become stigmatized in the region due to a long and troubled history of World Bank and especially IMF programs in the Americas. China's principle is we're not going to impose political conditions. We're not going to have you meet all of these conditions. Here's the money. So they've been investing a lot of money in the region. Now, what's some of the downsides? Many countries have lost their manufactured goods during the China boom. Toy companies, shoe companies, clothing, computers. The competitiveness of local Latin American products went down as cheaper Chinese imports came in and as currency appreciated. Problems are similar to the 19th century. If you only export raw materials, you are dependent on market conditions. You don't have anything invested in long-run development. You didn't capitalize on fully industrializing and being able to protect your, you know, beginning industries from the vagaries of the market because your industries then aren't competitive on the market. China demanded the energy and natural resources that it makes Latin America a good partner, but that extraction often leads to environmental degradation and social conflict. The geography and demographics of Latin America happen to place much of the region's natural resources in pristine or ecologically sensitive areas inhabited by local communities, often indigenous, who earn their livelihoods in the same areas that are sought for exploitation by these international firms and Latin American governments. Whereas creating new software packages or even sewing millions of tons of clothing in large factories is relatively benign from an environmental perspective, environmental degradation is endemic in the extractive industries. Almost every step of the mining process can have a significant environmental footprint. Soy farming and cattle ranching have similar environmental and social impacts and have distinct issues as well. Land conversion for soy and cattle threatens biodiversity. When such conversion entails clearing forests, the carbon stored in trees is released into the atmosphere, accelerating global climate change. Not to mention it exposes humans to new disease environments. Clearing also puts pressure on indigenous communities. In the soy sector, the pesticides impact water and irrigation capabilities, and those pesticides then go into local water supplies. Now, one aspect that cuts across the production of all these activities and significantly accentuates environmental damage is the expansion of access roads and other infrastructure projects to facilitate extraction and cultivation in remote areas. Infrastructure projects also facilitate the movement of other peoples and settlers, putting further pressure on water supplies, land, biodiversity, local communities, and native peoples. In Costa Rica, during the Xi Jinping and Obama were visiting, and they went to an art museum. There was a special exhibit on rethinking Costa Rican identity. And so this was a bunch of current artists who were coming in and creating exhibits. And one of them was Xi, you can't see what I'm doing. Well, yeah, you can on the side. So one was like Xi Jinping and Obama on this one side, and then they would bend in and they would kiss. So part of these projects are, Costa Rica likes to think of itself as the Switzerland of Central America. They don't have an army. And so they have different ways of, in which people will criticize the myths that they tell about themselves or that they push on Costa Rica. So this exhibit was called Bigamy, and it was an old-fashioned jack-in-the-box with the puppet in the middle, was dressed as a woman in traditional Costa Rican garb. And as you turn the handle, she would turn and kiss Obama, and then she would turn and kiss Xi Jinping to kind of show the like conflicting things in the region. You know, is it the US or is it going to be China? Now, the other downside is I said that there's a tacit agreement that, you know, if you accept this money that you'll use Chinese firms, but that often includes Chinese workers as well. So these large scale projects that they fund, they don't often hire actual local people. They'll bring in all of the material and the technology from China, and they'll bring in local workers, or they'll bring in Chinese workers as well. So they don't really generate local jobs. So the National Stadium in that last slide that was built, you know, this was built by, let me go back to it. So this National Stadium, this was built by Chinese firms with Chinese workers. So just try to imagine what problems could come from that if all the material and all the workers are coming from China. So they went to play their first soccer game. It got dark, and they couldn't figure out how to turn on the lights because all of the instructions were in Chinese. So they had to delay the game while people called China and then ask, how do we turn the lights on? Other times, you know, the US has defunded a lot of their Latin American programs, and this is why Chinese investment looks good. And another thing that they do, the reason I have this picture of like a festival, is that the Chinese don't just invest in these developments, they also will invest in cultural projects. Like, let's put on a Chinese New Year's festival or a festival of lights in the park so that it gets people, you know, thinking like our relationship with China is good and we wanna invest in these festivals, but they'll invest in local festivals as well, supporting local cultural events. So I think I have like 2 minutes left, 3 minutes left. So I'll just quickly kind of talk about how Africa is very similar. So from this map, you can see the Chinese investment offers in Africa since 2010. And as you can see, almost all of the investment is in kind of oil and mining. Those are the big ones. But then you have agribusiness as well. You have ports, you have transportation and sports stadiums. And like Latin America, these are Chinese firms that come in and build them, and they import Chinese workers to do it as well. So while again, the investment is often welcomed by the local governments because they're not told you need to slash health spending so that you can afford this loan, it doesn't often benefit locals in the way that they could get jobs and earn a living from these. So sure, they'll benefit from the end product, but local people aren't getting jobs. And then what can happen when you let Chinese firms come in and they do these big investments and they do these big loans? So here is the example of Hambantota. This is a port in Sri Lanka. And you can see the lovely billboard that the people of Sri Lanka warmly welcome His Excellency Xi Jinping, President of the People's Republic of China. So he's on the left, Mahinda Rajapaksa at the time was the president of Sri Lanka. $1 billion loan to build this port, and Sri Lanka could not pay it back. So what happens? That means that now China owns this port and owns the land that it is on. So this is one of the many worries that people have with the yuan diplomacy, with China investing, is that, you know, you can't pay back the loan, we get the land or the investment itself, and then we get all of the profits from it. So this is one of the worries of this kind of investment. But China sees this as, you know, this was its place in the world for most of its history, other than that, you know, late 19th, early 20th century blip. And they see this as how they're going to reclaim their place back on top of the world. So that concludes my presentation.
If anyone has any questions, now is the time to put them in the Q&A down at the bottom of your screen. And Maria would be happy to answer them. That was a lot to cover.
It was. I'm sorry, everyone. I was like, let's cram all of this in one.
A lot of history there.
But yeah, most of it is this idea of many Latin American African governments see it as a good thing because, you know, the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank put all these conditions on getting a loan. And then you just get deeper and deeper in debt with a loan and they demand cash. Whereas Chinese loans, you can pay some of it in kind, by like giving you oil or the soybeans or the product, so you don't have to come up with all of the cash. But there's a danger that if you can't pay back the loan, now they own the whole thing. You know, I'm not sure how much China has invested in US real estate and projects. It's a lot. I don't think it's quite as much as Latin America. But you know, both the US and China hold a lot of debt to each other. Like, they hold a lot of our debt and we hold some of their debt. So our economies are also tied together, not as closely as Latin America, but you know, as our economy has a blip, it affects China. When China has a blip, there you go, Michelle, that's part two, is let's get the US, that part of the Americas.
Great question. Anyone else? Okay. Question, wondering if the trade war with China tried to address yuan diplomacy or what were some of the goals?
Part of the trade war that's going on is that because so many of the firms in China are state owned, you know, it's state sponsored kind of capitalism, that there's this worry that, you know, they can subsidize and they can offer cheaper things. And so this then puts US goods more expensive. So if they're subsidizing, you know, if they're owning the agribusiness in Latin America that say is exporting the soybeans, this will be cheaper than if they're trying to buy US soybeans. And so part of the trade war is this idea that the US is saying like, this isn't fair when you're doing that kind of dealing. But I mean, the US, we subsidize our farmers all the time. I mean, that's why milk is so cheap. You know, I live in Wisconsin, the dairy land, and our farmers are dependent on those US subsidizing their farms. But maybe because China is like investing all over the world, the yuan diplomacy is definitely a little part of what they're trying to address.